prime on a level of principle, and then we'll get to the proof from our next theorem. Okay. So, as it exists, there it exists. Saying is that n naught of t tends to infinity as t tends to infinity. That's what this theorem is. But let me just make a comment here that Hardy actually proved n naught of t is greater than some constant times. Okay, this may be Hardy proved n naught of t greater than constant times t. And I will fill this part later. So now let me recall the preliminary lemmas. Okay. So let's take lemma one, which we proved last time, was let f be of the a and b, so this is valid for all intervals of arbitrary length, so to speak. Okay, lemma 2. So this we already proved. Okay, lemma 2 was also proved that f and g belong to c2. G not equal to zero, and f prime over g derivative have at most q distinct zeros in AB. Now we assume, suppose the derivative f prime of x divided by g of x is greater than or equal to m, is greater than zero, like here. Okay, then the integral from a to b of g of x, e to the power I f of x dx is less than or equal to, oh, I think I need one more condition which I didn't write down. No, that's plus 3 square root of 2 u plus 1 divided by. So we also proved this. Okay, so now let us get to the third lemma. Now, this lemma is very similar, but with a condition on the second derivative. So let f be in C2, AB, and let absolute value of f double prime of x be greater than or equal to some constant, we'll call this constant r, for all x in AB. So this is on the second derivative now. That's the only condition. Then, the integral from A to B, e to the power of I f of x dx is less than or equal to, I calculated this constant exactly, this is not interested in the value, you just put a but the important thing is this is square root of r. Don't worry about that constant, it's an absolute constant. Okay, so this is lemma 3, all right? Proof. Okay, so so we start with the following. Since f double prime is continuous, we are saying that f double prime in absolute value is greater than or equal to r, but f double prime is a continuous function, so there is no question of jumps taking place. We have either f double prime of x is greater than or equal to r, or f double prime of x is less than or equal to minus r for all x in AB. It's only one of two things. And whatever I say will apply equally to whatever this case or that case. So let us assume, without loss of generality, that f double prime of x be greater than or equal to r be greater than 0. Okay, so I'm going to call this as 3. I have to give a number there, but this is what I want. All right, so what does that mean? Thus, f double prime is greater than 0, which means that f prime is increasing and continuous. Thus, f prime has at most 1, 0 in A because it's an increasing function. All right. So let the 0 be in C. So you might say, what happens if there is no zero? Well, the proof will still apply equally well if there is no such C. Then we can, you'll see what I'm going to define, okay? Consider the following three intervals. Okay, now we pick a delta, some delta greater than zero, and consider the following three intervals. Three intervals are, well, if you denote by AB equal to I, the three intervals are I1 is from 0 to C minus delta, if C minus delta is greater than A. I mean, if there is a point C, and with this chosen delta, if I have greater than A, this is the integral. Otherwise, it is null. So these three intervals may not always exist. One of them could be null. Okay. I two is the integral C minus delta to C plus delta intersection I. Okay, and I three is exactly like this. It is C plus delta to B if C plus delta is less than B, and it is the null. So we have this. All right, so.
Should the first interval be A to C minus delta?
A to C, thank you. All right, so now, clearly, the integral from A to B, e to the I, f of x, dx, is the integral over I1, plus the integral over I2, plus the integral over I3. All right, so this is the definition, so we'll come to the form. So the integral is now broken up into three, but it need not be exactly three. It can be at most three, because one of these intervals could be zero by your choice of delta. So it doesn't matter. So now, first thing is, note that the integral over I2 is simply going to be less than or equal to the length of the interval. I'm going to be, there we're going to be proved, but we'll be more precise on the other side. So here, the interval over I2 is simply the interval of length delta. Its delta is going to be small, so I'm just going to say less than or equal to 2 delta. And that's typically what we do when we integrate and we have a small interval. We usually bound the integral by the length of the interval. Okay, so this is less than or equal to 2 delta. Now, we just make the following statement. If I3 is not null, that's the only case we're interested in terms of getting a bound, okay? If I3 is not null, then for x in I3, we have what? Well, I first will get a value for f prime of x. If I3 is not a null set, so that means this integral, this interval does exist, right? But first let me get f prime of x. I will think of f prime of x as the integral from C to x of f double prime of t dt, right? Because this is the antiderivative at that point minus the antiderivative at this point, but that's zero. But this is zero. That's how I chose the C. C could be the point where, the only point where it crosses the axis. All right, so I have this, but this is greater than or equal to, we made this assumption that f double prime is greater than or equal to r. So this is at least x minus c times r with the lower bound on f double prime. But x minus c is at least delta, because the existence of I3 as a non-null implies that the x minus correct, it's greater than delta. See, I3 goes from C plus delta onwards. So the distance of any point x in that interval to C would be at least delta. So you've got greater than or equal to delta r. Okay. So, second. But this is a lower bound on the f prime. And I now go to lemma one. Lemma one says that if there is a lower bound on the f prime, then I have got an upper bound on the integral. So by lemma one, we have the integral over I3. Now you see, the usefulness of that lemma does not depend upon the A and the B, even though it is stated that AB need not be this AB. I'm applying that lemma with the AB replaced by my C plus delta to B. And that bound does not depend upon the length of the interval. So the integral over I3 is now less than or equal to 3 square root of 2 divided by this delta power. So we have this uniform bound. Okay. And now we just say, similarly, if I1 is not empty, we have the integral over I1 is also less than or equal to 3 square root of 2 over delta r. Thus, the integral over from a to b, or I, the full integral, e to the I, f of x, dx, is now less than or equal to 2 delta plus 2 times this, plus 6 square root of 2 over r delta. So now we have to minimize this. The way you minimize is to set the two to be equal and choose the delta appropriately. Okay, so minimize the expression. On the right, and by choosing delta suitably. To get the bound. That's it. This little calculation. Okay, just set the two to be equal and you get the bound. Okay, so that's the strange bound that you get, but I would say, I mean, you don't have to go with a specific number there. Lemma 4. So let F be in C2AB, and the absolute value of F double prime of x be greater than or equal to r, be greater than or equal to 0 for all x in AB. Same hypothesis as in lemma 3, but now we introduce this function g. G be satisfy that the absolute value of g of x is less than or equal to some bound m. So we're going to apply it with the Riemann zeta function bounds that we're going to get. Okay. So this is less than or equal to m for all x and a. And now we go like in lemma 2. Let f prime over g prime derivative f prime over g prime, that's what I meant, have at most q distinct zeros in AB. Then the claim is that the integral from A to B g of x, e to the I, f of x, dx, is less than or equal to that same constant that you had in that lemma, okay? 4 square root of 3 times whatever, 2. But now, you're going to have the same r, but here, it's not just going to be q plus 1, it's going to be multiplied by n. So why is it that we needed the m? Where does the m play a role? Remember, all through here, we used the conditions on the F double prime, or a condition on the F prime, and we used an earlier lemma. The only place where we did not use any condition, but used the crudest upper bound, was on the short interval. We simply said the e to the power of I f of x is a function bounded by 1, or its absolute value 1. So the integral is simply bounded by the length of the interval, and the length of the interval is 2 delta. But now, we don't just have the e to the I, I've got a g. So I have got to assume a bound on the g to bound that interval. But you will say that's a bound on the g locally. Why do I need a bound on the g globally? But the point is, we don't know where this crossing takes place for this f. This is uniform for all f, any f. So the crossing could take place anywhere. So we just have a uniform upper bound on the values of g throughout the interval. We call it m, and that's the m that you get here. But now I have a comment that if you really, so this is just a remark, okay? So remark is that, okay, there is the m, but if you actually go through this proof, that m will come here. So if you do your optimization, you'll actually end up with a square root of m size on top, not just m, because you're going to match delta with delta, you get delta squared, okay? So just make a comment here. The optimization will actually replace the m by something of the size of the square root of m. But this is a comment, okay? The optimal choice of delta will replace m by square root of m in lemma 4. But we don't need anything that sharp. We're just going to use a certain thing. All right. Now, I'm going to state something important. Important not just in this course, but in general in applications of complex predicate theory. It's called the Fragman-Lindelof theorem. So there are several Fragman-Lindelof theorems, but I will state it in the form in which we need in the most general form. Okay, so A, Fragman-Lindelof theorem. Is this covered in the standard complex analysis course? Okay, so but I explain what the theorem is. Okay, so what is this theorem? And if we have time before we close for Thanksgiving, I want to first finish the Hardy proof and then some oscillation theorems. So if I have a little spare time on Monday before we move, then I will indicate a proof of the Fragman-Lindelof theorem. Okay. So the Fragman-Lindelof theorem, in the form in which I'm going to state, is we know the bounds of a function on two vertical lines. In our case, it's going to be the boundary of the critical strip, the one line and the zero line. And then we want a bound on the interior. Such a bound can be obtained provided you assume that the function doesn't grow too fast in the interior. So the beauty about the Fragman-Lindelof theorem is the condition that the function doesn't grow too fast is going to be a very weak condition. It'll be like e to the something. And that will still give you a much sharper bound based upon the bounds that you see on the boundary. Okay, so that's the powerful nature of the Fragman-Lindelof theorem. Okay, so let me just state the theorem, and it actually gives you a convexity. So what is the Fragman-Lindelof theorem? So let f of s be analytic for in a less than or equal to sigma, less than or equal to b. So it's analytic in this strip. Okay. Now let f satisfy. And I will explain this condition. The absolute value of f of s is going to be less than e to the power some constant times t. Now there is a bound on the constant. It's not just you can't just explode like that, with the constant k being less than pi divided by b minus a. So I'll explain why the pi divided by b minus a is brought into the picture. What is the reason for? We need to put some bound on the constant, but why this bound? Where is pi coming in? Okay. Also, let the absolute value of f of s be less than or equal to some bound on the line A. So let us say this is less than some constant A times, you have to put A, you can't just put s, so I've got to shift it by some number. So I'm going to just put a q plus s to the power of alpha. And this is in for sigma equal to A. And is less than or equal to some other constant times q plus s to the power of beta. For this beta is not the real part of the zero of the Riemann zeta function, which is some parameter, for sigma equal to b. What about q? Well, q is just brought in to ensure that these quantities are not zero. So we want q plus s to be bigger than zero. So that means q plus, okay, so we want q plus sigma. So we want q to be greater than minus a. And if the moment q plus a is greater than 0, automatically q plus b is greater than 0. So q is just chosen in such a way that it doesn't make the 0. But the role of q does not really play any role, because eventually it is s which is large. And the absolute value of this to the power of alpha depends upon the imaginary part of s. It's on that vertical strip. So q doesn't play a role, except technically to assure that you don't have a zero there to get the size of the function. Okay, so suppose this is true, then the bound that you get is really beautiful. Then, for all s satisfying sigma b, okay, we have the absolute value of f of s is less than or equal to. Sometimes the fragment and log theorem is stated without the explicit constant. They just put a less than, less than. But this is, it's good to have a good explicit constant. It is a to the power b minus sigma over b minus a, b to the power sigma minus a over b minus a, times q plus s to the power alpha times sigma minus b minus sigma over b minus a plus beta times sigma minus a over b minus a. So let's understand this. So what is going on here? Let us not get to the constant yet. Let us get to understanding this problem. So what we are saying here is, I've got A, I've got B. Focus on the alpha and beta. There are some exponents. So on this strip, this function is growing no faster than t to the power of alpha. On this type, it's growing no faster than t to the power of beta. So just imagine, I know it's incorrect really here. I'm going to put an alpha here to denote the size. This alpha is not on this strip. I'm going to denote beta here to denote the size. It's only the size. Now consider the line which joins alpha and beta on this AB. The value there for any sigma is this. That's the straight line connecting the two points. So what we're saying is that the size of the function inside the critical strip is no bigger than t to that power. No bigger. So the actual, what you can do is you can define m sigma to be the sort of the supremum of that, and it will really mean a convex kind of thing. It has to be convex. It'll never exceed the sizes given by that. And then the same sort of thing holds for the constant, implicit constant a and b also. So that's the Fragment Little Log theorem that we are going to use. Now, just a comment. Why is this? I'll give you two reasons why pi over b minus a is coming in. Okay, two reasons. But then later, as I think we have time, we'll prove this. One reason is the Fragment Little Log theorem is often stated for a sector. Okay, so often, so Fragment Little Log, so PL theorem, is often stated for a sector. So we're talking about a sector like this. So what that means is, you have a bound here, and you have a bound there. Provided you have some reasonable growth condition on this, you can bound the function in the interior. But that thing depends, that the bound depends upon the opening of this sector. Okay? And so these are two angles that come in. And so that's your angle above, angle below, the opening of the sector. Pi comes because of the total. So this is one reason why the pi will play a role in the opening of the sector. All right. Now, you can transform a sector into a vertical strip by going to the argument. Because if you look at arg, the arg on this is constant. That means the angle. The arg on this is constant. So if I use the arg map, this maps to a strip. And the fragment limit law will apply to the strip with maximum width pi. Okay? But that means this width is pi, but you can, by translation, if the width is not pi, but if the width is AB, you have got to do a scaling, and that's why you are getting this pi over B minus A. I mean, so that's the reason when you do this transformation, you got pi over B minus A. Right? So this is one reason. There is a second reason, and I think you will appreciate this. Instead of a vertical strip, let me go to a horizontal strip, just to illustrate. Okay. So consider the function f of z equal to e to the e to the z. This function is entire. Now, how does this function behave in the plane? So let us look at the horizontal strip, positive part. And let us say this is pi over 2 height, and this is minus pi over 2. So that means this point is I pi over 2, minus I pi over 2. Now, look at the behavior of this function on this line. Now, every point on this line is of the form x plus I pi over 2. So that's this point. So what is e to the e to the z? E to the x plus I pi over 2, right? And that is equal to e to the x times e to the I pi over 2. But e to the I pi over 2 is purely imaginary, because it's cosine pi over 2. Plus I, right? It's purely imaginary, just the number I. Okay, good. So this is e to the power I, e to the power x. So what I meant was, it's e to a purely imaginary number, which means it's bounded. It's absolute value 1. So this function has absolute value 1 here. Similarly, it'll have absolute value 1 here.